Our next lesson is to talk about concentration of particles in solution, because we're going to be going down a road where we're going to talk about things called colligative properties. And colligative properties depend upon the amount of particles in solution, the number of particles. So the more particles you dissolve, the greater this property, the lower this property, or what have you. So we're going to be connecting it. We need to realize that when we go and pick up a bottle off the shelf and it's reading that it's 0.1 molar sodium chloride, that 0.1 molar is the concentration of the whole thing, and it's not telling you the concentration of the particles. So let's see what the difference is as we go through here. Electrolytes versus non-electrolytes. We mentioned this in, you know, previous general chemistry course, the first semester course, but this is just a reminder and pull it forward. Electrolytes, when you dissolve them in water, break apart into ions, okay? So ionic compounds all do this. When you dissolve them in here, they break apart into a cation and an anion. They are electrolytes. Acids and bases also, when you dissolve them, break apart. Some completely, they're strong electrolytes. Some only partially, meaning some of them break apart and some of them don't. But they're still electrolytes. They break apart when you dissolve them in water. So here's ionic compounds listed here as examples. Silver nitrate, ammonium chloride, magnesium chloride, they break apart into particles. And here are some examples of acids and bases. The first two are acids. The first one is a strong acid, completely breaks apart into ions. The next one is weak, meaning only some of the hydrogens come off of the compound. The next one is a metal hydroxide, so it is a base. It's a strong base. It completely breaks apart into barium ions and hydroxide ions. And ammonium is a weak base. It only partially engages in the reaction, so it forms partial ions. So those are your electrolytes. They break apart into ions. And if we need to know about the concentration of particles, we need to be aware that some of them are breaking apart into ions. Now, your non-electrolytes do not break apart into ions. When you dissolve them, they stay intact. And many things would fit this description of being a non-electrolyte. Your covalent compounds that are neither acids nor bases, they're covalent but not acids and bases, would fit this category. So if we look through the list and we see all nonmetals, and we're not seeing that polyatomic ion cation NH4+ in there, they're just all nonmetals, then you're going to be dealing with a non-electrolyte, provided it is not on your acid and base radar. Acids we recognize because H is at the beginning. Bases we recognize by there either being a nitrogen with three components attached to it, like we see with the NH3, or we see a metal with a hydroxide. Now, some people would look at that CH3OH and say, isn't that a hydroxide? Well, it's not, because it's not a metal and an OH. All of those C's and H's and O's and H's are combined with covalent bonds, and they don't break apart when you dissolve them. So those are electrolytes versus non-electrolytes. When we talk about concentration and we see a concentration listed for a substance, we're talking about the whole compound, and that would be the concentration of the solute that's being dissolved. But we're going to need to know about the concentration of the particles that are in there. So let us think about that. If it's a non-electrolyte, it doesn't break apart. So the concentration of that solute is the concentration of the particles that are in there. They're one and the same. That's always going to be true for your non-electrolytes. But for your electrolytes, when you dissolve it, it's going to break apart into ions. So the concentration of what you dissolved is not the same as the concentration of the ions in there. If it breaks apart into two particles, you just doubled how many particles are dissolved in there. So it's not always double, it could be triple, it could be less than double. But there's always, if it's an electrolyte, going to have more particles than you have solute dissolved. So let's think about this. How many particles will silver nitrate break apart into? Pause and answer that. Well, the right answer would be two. It breaks apart into two particles. Now, you might have to go back and review your polyatomic ions. On the Concepts to Memorize page that we provide for you, we have a list of the common polyatomic ions. You might not have looked at that and seen this staring at you as a, oh, obvious polyatomic ion. When this guy dissolves, it breaks apart into silver ions, okay, and nitrate ions, and it's important that you can see that. So if you don't recognize your polyatomic ions, you're going to have a hard time recognizing that, okay? Now, if we go into a stock room and we see a label where a solution is 0.10 molar AgNO3, we're saying that we are dissolving 0.10 moles in a liter of solution or some equivalent. You know, it might be half that in half a liter or twice that in 1 liter, but this is that ratio of moles per liter of that. So the question is, if this is actually breaking apart into these two particles, what is the concentration of particles in solution? Well, the answer would be twice that. If this is breaking apart into two particles, when it breaks apart, it's breaking apart and giving me 0.1 moles per liter of the silver ions and 0.1 moles per liter of the nitrate ions. We're getting twice the number of particles. Now, sometimes students say, well, we're breaking it apart, so it's gonna be half that, okay? This thing breaks apart into breaks in half, so it's half the concentration. But we are breaking it apart and having two different things, and we're adding up how many particles are floating in there, so we end up with twice as many particles. All right, what about this one? What's the concentration of particles if the solution is barium hydroxide? I want you to start by thinking about this guy. If this were to dissolve into water and it is a strong electrolyte, what do we have on this side of the equation? We're going to have barium ions and they have a 2 plus charge. And how many hydroxides? This is the way we write that. There would be 2 hydroxides in there for every one of these that I dissolve. So we put in and dissolved that much. When it breaks apart, we're going to have this amount of the barium, okay? And we're going to have twice that amount of the hydroxide. So when we add this together, we're going to have 0.15 molar of particles, okay? So when we go to a stockroom and we pull off the shelf a solution that is labeled as this concentration of barium hydroxide, this doesn't exist in solution at all. It's not there, but that's how it's labeled. What really exists in solution is 0.05 molar barium ions floating around independent of each other, and 0.1 molar of hydroxide ions floating around independent of each other, so a total of 0.15 moles of particles in solution. Now, we've gone through these two examples. I want you to stop, and I want you to look at these three, and I want you to decide which one of these is the correct answer by putting in the letter, okay, for the correct answer. Now, what you're looking at here is each one of these things, you're deciding whether or not it's an electrolyte or non-electrolyte, how many particles it's going to break apart into, and how that affects the concentration of particles. Okay, so hopefully you chose the answer D, okay? This is a non-electrolyte. Non-electrolyte, it doesn't break apart into particles at all. So we would eliminate this guy, and this guy right off the bat because we know the concentration of particles has got to be the same as the concentration of that. Now, how many particles does this one break apart into? It breaks apart into 2 particles, okay? It's going to break apart into sodium ions and nitrate ions. So if we double the 0.18, we're going to get the 0.36. So that is giving me this one. I can eliminate the other two. But let's verify that 0.54 is correct here. This guy, what does it break apart into? When it dissolves, it's going to have 2 sodium ions and 1 sulfate ion. Okay, so that's 3 particles. And so if we take the 0.18 times 3, we're going to get that answer. So now we can determine the concentration of particles in your solution, whether they are non-electrolytes or electrolytes. Now, we have a term for this number it breaks apart into. It's called the Vant-Hoff factor. The Vant-Hoff factor is abbreviated with a italicized I, and it is used to really look at how many particles does it break apart into, and that is a quick way, once you see that, to multiply your concentration by to get a concentration of particles. This is the actual definition of the Vant-Hoff factor. The actual number of particles in the solution, which we would be kind of tagging in on this, divided by the formula unit, okay? So this seems kind of a strange definition, but okay, whatever this is divided by this is going to be your Vant-Hoff factor. The fact of the matter is, in reality, while we say this is happening 100%, maybe ever so slightly a few of these stay, maybe one of these hydroxides stays attached here in a few instances, and you might in reality in measurements get you 0.14 instead of 0.15. That could be measured and determined, and an I is not exactly 3 as we would predict it to be here, but we're going to, for all purposes, basically, I is this, for all practical purposes, and we're going to stay practical in this class. The I is the number of ions in that strong electrolyte, okay? You look at your ionic compound, and you don't have to do all this and say 0.15 divided by 0.05, oh, that gives me 3. You can just look here and say, oh, there's a barium ion and 2 hydroxide ions, that's 3. So this would have a Vant-Hoff factor of 3. We look at this guy and it has a silver ion and a nitrate ion, that's 2. So we have a Vant-Hoff factor of 2. This is going to be true for your ionic compounds, your strong acids, and your strong bases. We'll keep it practical, okay? Now, if it's a non-electrolyte, it's going to be an I of 1 because they don't break apart. They can still have the final concentration after it dissolved versus how many dissolved. They're the same number, so that's an I of 1. And then you could have the world of weak acids and weak bases. They're going to be somewhere between 1 and 2. They're not going to break apart entirely, and that would be 2. They're going to break apart some. If they didn't at all, it would be 1. So we know it's somewhere in the middle ground, and generally they're much closer to 1 than they are to 2. But they aren't just one. They're not non-electrolytes. Okay, so what we'll move on to in our next lesson is why we study all of this. Why do we need to know the Vant-Hoff factor? Why do we need to know the concentration of particles instead of just the concentration of what you dissolved? And it has everything to do with colligative properties. So stay tuned as we define colligative properties.